Hi, this is Victor Pierantoni, and in today's video we're going to be talking about the power of language and definitions and the influence that they have on the way you feel and the way that you make decisions. Stay tuned. So often people underestimate the power that their language and their words have on their reality. The truth is that the way that we communicate, the tool that we use ultimately and the most, is our language. Now, people underestimate this because they don't realize that the impact that their words have on their reality. See, how you define everything, the definitions that you set for things, is ultimately going to impact the way that you make a decision and the way that you feel. Language is often pretty underestimated in the sense that people don't really give it the value of what it actually creates in your life, the impact that it actually has on the way that you feel. So a lot of the time when we want to make decisions or we're describing something that we're dissatisfied with, for example, we use language that's really soft. You know, there's this whole wave of, you know, it's 2016, there's this whole wave of PC culture and being politically correct with your words and really softening what you're saying. And the problem is we do this a lot to ourselves. And the thing that inspires change is an emotion of resourcefulness. And you're never gonna get to the peak of that emotional state if you're using language that doesn't accurately describe what you're saying. So just to give you an example, there's a big difference in saying, I feel pretty good, rather than saying, I feel phenomenal. You know, there's a huge difference in feeling because the language that you use, the words that you use, serve as a filter for what you're feeling. So whatever you're filtering out, you're using your language and you're filtering those feelings through that. So you want to use a language that actually expresses what you want and expresses accurately and allows you to speak from a place of authenticity. So the way that you'll ultimately want to speak to yourself, you know, regarding what you think, your decisions, the way you feel about things, is using the language of opulence, being resourceful with your language. So that's one, not lying to yourself in your language and trying to soften it by using something like, oh, well, I guess this thing isn't so bad, or, you know, it's okay. I don't really like it. If you don't like something, if you're dissatisfied with something, you need to be honest with yourself and be authentic with yourself. And at the same time, with that authenticity and that honesty to yourself and how you feel about something, you also want to see it better than it is and use the language of opulence and expansiveness so that you can actually speak in a way that directs you of what you want to become, directs you to your result. One thing that we really want to focus on is the words that we use, and I'm talking about even the simple transition words. Words like but versus the words and. So when you use the word but, you're ultimately cutting things off. You're cutting off whatever you said before it. If somebody were to say to you, you know, this looks good but, or that shirt looks nice but, it's obvious that that compliment isn't going to be taken on in the way that it was intended, right? That but negates whatever was said before it. So you've had the experience before where somebody said to you, you know, your hair looks nice, but, and all of a sudden, no matter what they say after that, you're like, this is not, they're not being genuine. On some level, you understand that what they're not listening or they're not appreciating because they've used that word. So instead of using the word but, we want to use words like and, things that include, things that expand. Okay, another area where this is powerful is when people talk about things that they need to do, when they're speaking about coming from a place of obligation, whether it's with their work, with their school, with, you know, an obligation to a friend, they'll say something like, I have to do this, or why do I have to work this job? Why do I have to work this, right? So think about that wording there, have to. They're implying some kind of constriction. When you use words, rather than saying I have to, when you say I get to, you know, I get to work this job, I have this opportunity where I get to, you know, support the things that I want to do, where I get to, you know, put food on my table, where I get to support my family. Rather than saying I have to work this job, you want to move from a place of constriction to a place of expansion. So, to give you an example of an expansive definition, a lot of people, when they define what they, you know, see as success, for example, they'll say, well, I'll be successful when I've made $10 million, or I'll be successful when I live in this mansion, or when I drive a Ferrari. To say that, you're ultimately cutting off from your definition, right? So when you're talking about definitions and language, you want to be expansive in your vocabulary. If you were to constrict your definition to just one thing, saying, I'll be successful when this, this, and that, right? Rather, you use an example like personal development pioneer Earl Nightingale in his definition of success, where he said, success is the progressive realization of a worthy ideal. So if you listen to that definition, it's expansive in its nature, because you think about the word progressive, I mean, it's ever growing, it's changing. Realization is something, it's a process of discovery. Worthy ideal. So this one is important, especially when it comes to your definitions of language. When you look at success as a progressive realization of your own worthy ideal, what you're doing is you're ultimately saying that this idea of whatever you're pursuing, whatever you're after, needs to be worthy of you. It is worthy of your life, because you have to remember, anytime you're committing yourself, you know, day in and day out, you're essentially trading your life, you're trading your feeling, your emotion for this thing. You're sacrificing what you need in order to get to this place. So just in the definition itself and the language that you use around this, a worthy ideal has to be worthy of you. It has to be your ideal from an authentic place. So when we speak with the language of opulence, when we speak expansive in that way, we want to speak in a way that allows us options, allows us, you know, growth and development in the things that we say. We don't want to constrict ourselves with our definitions. So even thinking in terms of metaphors, right? Metaphors speak the language of experience. So when we use metaphors, it's ultimately, it's almost like we feel them. You know, when people say, I've hit a wall, I'm sure, you know, we've all been in that situation where we feel like we've hit a wall, or we feel like we're blocked by something. We say, you know, something is blocking me. Using those metaphors, we almost see that and feel that in our bodies, even though it's not actually happening, but our imagination takes it as such. So we want to pay attention to the metaphors that we use, because those, rather than, you know, drawing in with a pencil regarding our words, a metaphor is almost like painting a picture. It creates a lot more vivid experience of how we're gonna actually feel. So we wanna pay attention to our metaphor. If you say, I've hit a wall, maybe you wanna add to that, and I'm gonna run through this wall. Another thing to pay attention to is the way that we define things, the way that we define our reality, because our definitions are ultimately going to shape the way we experience everything. Right? So if we define something in a way that's not solvable, in a way that traps us, then ultimately the decisions that we make are going to keep us stuck. So for example, if you're talking about a problem that you have, let's say your problem is that you can't lose weight, or maybe you can't be in the relationship that you want to be in, or even a problem in business. You know, maybe you're saying to yourself, well, I can't get these customers because nobody wants to see what I have to offer. If you're thinking in terms of relationship, maybe someone will say, you know, well, all the good ones are taken. Yes, you may be feeling that way, and maybe you haven't found somebody who is essentially good for you or the right person for you, but saying that is ultimately going to close you off to being able to see those things. Remember, wherever your focus goes, your energy flows. So rather than saying all the good ones are taken, you can say something like, I'm on my way to finding the right person for me, or I'm on my way to finding my soulmate. Or regarding business, if you're thinking to yourself, maybe, oh, nobody wants what I have to offer, you think to yourself, I'm developing my gifts in order to serve the people that need what I have, right? It's a much different way of thinking about it. You define things in a way that's winnable for you, in a way that's expansive, and you speak with that language of opulence. Thank you for watching. If this video helped or added value to your life, please like, share, and subscribe. Otherwise, leave a comment at breakthroughtovictory.com.